Jane holds a master's in art history from Boston University and a master's in education from the Harvard University Graduate School of Education. She is a New Hampshire native and has worked at some of the state's most esteemed cultural institutions, including the League of New Hampshire Craftsmen, where she served as executive director, and the Currier Museum of Art, where she held the role of senior educator. Jane founded the Currier's Alzheimer's Cafe and led the tour program for the museum and the Frank Lloyd Wright designed Zimmerman House. She has taught art history at the college level for more than a decade, most recently at the New Hampshire Institute of Art. Her organization is called Culturally Curious, and Culturally Curious's mission is to engage, educate, and unify groups through facilitated art experiences that inspire joy and foster critical and creative thinking, as well as an appreciation for our shared humanity. And tonight she presents The Art of the Scandal, Thefts, Vandals, and Forgeries. This program explores some of the most brazen criminal acts in the art world and features works by artists including Da Vinci, Michelangelo, and Rembrandt. Learn more about the works that were targeted and how they were recovered and restored for our enjoyment today. And so with that, again, please submit any questions you have to the chat. And I really appreciate you coming online with us again, Jane.
Thank you, Jess. It's absolutely my pleasure. So thank you everybody for joining us tonight. I'm delighted that you're interested in the material. And as always, I am honored to be the person to share a little bit more information with you about this. So this is really fun, sort of like true crime stuff that we're going to be looking at tonight. And even though a lot of the details are kind of interesting and salacious, because our interest in coming together tonight is really about the works of art themselves, I'm going to be trying to talk about those works as much as I am, if not a little bit more, about the crimes. So that being said, we'll probably be a little bit heavy on the thefts and vandals piece of this, because the forgeries, in the end, they're copies. So they're not really an interesting extension or opportunity to examine the works in a new way. So that being said, we'll be together for about the next hour. Feel free to type up any questions or comments in the chat along the way. And let's get started. I wanted to start off with the idea of thefts, vandals, and forgeries, it really big picture before we even give you sort of the lay of the land for tonight. The big picture when it comes to theft is that cultural theft is nearly as old as the production of art itself. So if you're looking at these two images on the screen, you might recognize them. On the right, we have the Parthenon on the Acropolis in Greece. And over here on the left, we have the sculptures that were created specifically for that triangular space up here on top of the Parthenon. They are known as the Elgin Marbles, and they are probably one of the oldest, most famous accounts of cultural theft that there is. These are sculptures that are now in the collection of the British Museum, but for many in Greece and beyond, it's believed that they really belong right there on the Parthenon. Like I mentioned, they're specifically designed for that space. You can sort of get the gist of the fact that these sculptures in particular sort of create that half of that triangular composition that they would have been relegated to there. And I particularly love how the horse heads are like coming up into that, to the edge of that triangle. So there was a Scottish lord named Elgin who negotiated for the sale of these objects about 200 years ago. And ever since they've been removed and brought to another country, it's been the subject of a great deal of controversy. Certainly the people of Greece and you know, the cultural ambassadors there would be seeking to have these artifacts back. So the very notion of where an object belongs once it's made is really interesting to me. But let's keep in mind this idea of cultural theft is one that's as old as the ages, really. The next idea here, art attacks. This is one that is sort of at the front of our brains these days because it's part of our national dialogue to a certain extent. And so I brought in two images here to remind us that destroying art is also as old as the production of art itself. The image over here on the left is a historical one dating to the 1850s. It's a representation of the Sons of Liberty pulling down a sculpture of George III. So it's this notion that around the time of the American Revolution, that here in America, we were destroying images of the monarch. And of course, this wasn't painted contemporary to those times. So it's sort of a nostalgic invention in many ways. But we know that that still happens today. When America invaded Iraq back in the early 2000s, one of the first things we did was go in and tear down sculptures of Saddam Hussein. So it's interesting to think of the destruction of art as an assertion of power in so many ways. And like I said, we see that playing out with sculptures of, you know, Confederate generals even still. So our last big idea tonight relates to that notion of forgery. And forgery, or copying an artwork, is again as old as time. We're looking at this fantastic image by an American painter named Samuel F.B. Morse. And this is a depiction of people copying paintings in a gallery in the Louvre Museum. This painting dates to 1831. And so we can see several art students here with their easels and canvases carefully studying the old masters. And this was part of an artist's training for centuries, is to look at the great works that came before them and to emulate them, to try and create a sort of a perfect copy before they could even go on and create works that were essentially in their own voice. So this is kind of a perfect segue too, because in this gallery in the Louvre, you might recognize a few works, namely this lady down here. And this is somebody that we're going to be spending some time with in just a moment. But let's get started with the lay of the land and how we'll move through the material tonight. We're going to start off talking about robbery or art heists. We'll look at the Mona Lisa. We'll consider Hitler and how he stole and moved art around Europe during World War II. And then we will finish up that section with the Gardner Museum heist, which I'm sure, being just outside of Boston, almost everybody has heard this story. There's also the great Netflix documentary right now called This is a Robbery. I feel like I bring special insight into that story because I gave tours at the Gardner Museum for many years, and I feel like I know that collection like the back of my hand. Then we'll move on to vandalism. I'm just fascinated by people who attack works of art, the reasonings behind it, and then sort of what happens to these works that we know and love so well. So we'll be looking at some old masterworks, Michelangelo, Rembrandt, and then turn our attention to some contemporary destruction with the graffiti artist Banksy. And then after all that, we'll just sort of kind of glide across the surface of a couple of different frauds here in terms of forgery. And there's some major artists that we, whose names we're familiar with, who committed sort of acts of fraud with their works. But then there are also prominent forgers who recreate works by famous artists. And we'll take a look very quickly in terms of how they did that and what happened with those forgeries. So a lot to cover, and let's get started with art heists. The image that I have here on the screen is not the actual theft of the Mona Lisa. It's this is from a silent film that was made just after the theft. So let's get started here with art heists and looking at the most famous painting in the world. And I love to start off with that notion that she is the most famous painting in the world. Painted, of course, by Leonardo da Vinci, 1503. It's a work that I think sort of captures the popular imagination for so many different reasons. Perhaps number one, just the fact that da Vinci kept this particular painting with him for the next 15 or so years of his life. His personal attachments to it seems to intrigue so many people. Also, of course, the smile. We know that Da Vinci, as a Renaissance man through and through, was really interested in anatomy and that he had studied the muscles of the face. He was very familiar and very interested with how facial muscles move and how a smile is created. So neuroscientists today are still studying, you know, what makes this particular picture so intriguing. And essentially the way our eye first understands this smile, it appears as though, first impressions, she's smiling more broadly than she actually is. That's the way our eyes and our mind perceive it. So it provides this continuing mystery because the actual fact of the picture is different from our initial impression. So there's a number of fascinating things going on with this picture in particular. But I wanted to share with you very quickly what makes it so special. Why do people flock to it at the Louvre Museum? Why might someone have been interested in stealing it? Well, I wanted to compare it with a contemporary piece done within a few years of the Mona Lisa. And this is a picture that's up here in Manchester, New Hampshire, in my hometown, done by another Italian artist. And I think it sort of underscores a big difference in the way that Leonardo da Vinci was painting at the time. Prior to his innovations in terms of shading and modeling and the way that he suggests the three-dimensional form of the Mona Lisa's face, you can see that artists were relying pretty heavily on distinct lines. And I think that's how most of us would draw right now too. If given a pencil and asked to draw a face, we'd be drawing the hard lines to define, you know, the edge of the face, the edge of the nose, the shape of the lips. And so we see these clear, hard lines throughout to suggest those features. But then when we move over to the Mona Lisa, Da Vinci's great innovation here that we see in her face and in her hands too is this kind of smudgy shadowing. And you particularly see it, you know, around her cheeks, just under her chin. And so he's taken away those hard lines that, of course, don't exist in the world around us when we look at things. And he's created something that seems more lifelike in that way. So this is all a huge preamble to, you know, why is this picture so popular? I'm sure if any of you have ever been to the Louvre Museum before, you've probably, like me, run through some of these galleries trying to find what is a relatively small picture in just this absolutely enormous museum. If you spent 30 seconds on every single work of art at the Louvre Museum, it would take you, I think, 100 days to see every single object there. This is such an enormous collection. So you finally get to this room where there's all these people crushing in to see this work of art. There's all these signs that say no photography, but of course everybody there is taking a picture of the work, perhaps a selfie with themselves in the work. So why? Why are people so fascinated? Well, even prior to the theft of this work of art, people were kind of in love with the Mona Lisa. She actually used to get fan mail and love letters at the Louvre. And in some cases, there were even people that even committed suicide, leaving notes addressed to her. But it wasn't until 1911, when she was stolen off the walls of the galleries of the Louvre Museum, that she became a worldwide sensation. So how do you just walk out of the Louvre with this really popular, notable work of art? Well, if there's anybody with us tonight on this Zoom who's ever worked at a museum, you probably know that it takes a lot of communication between different departments to convey what is supposed to be on view and what isn't supposed to be on view. I've worked at several very small museums in New England over the years where that communication just didn't exist and things would go off view and you just assume that a curator is behind it. But at one particular small museum that I worked at in Connecticut for some time, I remember the director stopping by my office and mentioning that that a sculpture that had been outside that I had noticed wasn't there for about a month. He happened to mention that it had been stolen, and he had just realized it about a month later. So things move around, and they really have to be accounted for. And that's essentially what happened with the theft of the Mona Lisa. It was an Italian man who was living in France, working at the Louvre Museum, and he realized he could take this painting off the wall and essentially walk out the door with it. If you've ever been to the Louvre, it's so enormous. I believe it's about 700,000 square feet of space. So it's not like there was tight security back then. So, I believe it took over a day before they realized that it was gone, and it was stolen, not just gone, taken off view. So there were a couple of factors there that sort of made it a little bit easier for somebody to steal it. And when it went missing, I should mention too, there was just this kind of national outpouring of grief. It was sort of similar to like when Princess Diana died. It like transformed the nation. Women started powdering their faces with this kind of yellow powder to take on the look of the Mona Lisa. She became this kind of national icon. And there were all sorts of theories in terms of who might have stolen it. In fact, Picasso was even interviewed by the police because he was suspected of being the robber in this case. But in the end, as I mentioned, it was an Italian national who felt that this important Italian masterpiece belonged back in Italy. So while it was missing for 2 years, believe it or not, before I get to that, let me just show you the gallery where it was stolen from. So you can see, as a tiny work of art, which I believe was supposed to be on view right over here, it didn't hold the room in the same way that it does today. It was competing with a lot of other works. And again, there's this notion that you know, you might not have even missed it being gone. While it was gone, believe it or not, the robber sort of lent it out to a forger, who then made 6 copies of the Mona Lisa and sold them to American collectors, each for $100,000 at the time. And this isn't one of those copies, but it gives you a sense in terms of what those copies might have looked like. And then ultimately, the painting was returned, and the man who stole it was sentenced to 6 months in jail, just 6 months, amazingly. And when it came back to the Louvre, it sort of got a better installation, a more noteworthy installation. And of course, its fame was growing and growing and growing from there. So amazingly, people started to come to the Louvre, of course, just to see it, but then also to attack it. So we can even see the damage that it suffered due to one particular attack, but people were somebody's thrown a rock at it, somebody's thrown acid at it, and even today it's behind bulletproof glass, but people still throw things at it. One woman bought a mug at the gift shop and even threw the mug at the bulletproof glass. So all of this fame, and sometimes people do these things in order to draw attention to a political cause, that sort of thing. But in the end, how wonderful that it can't be damaged now. But in the end, all of this attention and all of this protection and all of the value that this picture now has is really due to the fact that somebody took it away from us. And we all felt this sort of sense of indignation that no, this is our cultural treasure, and it belongs to sort of, if not the people of France, then at least to the world, and it should be accessible in that way. So that's sort of the fascinating story behind the Mona Lisa and why it's so famous. So, I mean, this is like a fun anecdote. The next time you're talking art with friends, you can always say, do you know why the Mona Lisa is the most famous work of art in the world? Now, we're going to turn our attention now to somebody who was nowhere near as successful as Da Vinci, even though he certainly aspired to be. And that artist is Hitler. I think it's always good for us to keep in mind that he was a failed artist. He certainly had some skill in the area of art. These are both examples of his artwork. But he was failed in the sense that he couldn't really launch a career as an artist. And when we look at these two works, we can see that they're very traditional. They're very much wedded to realism. He wasn't really producing anything innovative at a time when when avant-garde art was all the rage. And so he felt this this disdain for avant-garde art. He called it degenerate art even. So as Hitler began to gain power in Europe and set his sights very high in terms of European domination, art and cultural theft played a huge part in terms of how he imagined what Europe would look like after he assumed power or took power. So here we have Hitler, of course, and right next to him here is a plan for his hometown of Linz. And in Linz, he planned to create a new cultural capital for Europe. And at the center of Linz would be this museum. And so he wanted to tell essentially the story of European art at this museum. And in order to do that, he knew he had to acquire the best works from museums and collections all over Europe. So in some cases he was forcing sales. In other cases, of course, and when I say he, sometimes it was his henchmen, but these were his enacting his orders and essentially fulfilling his will. So in some cases it was forced sales, but in a lot of cases it was the seizure of property. And it was anywhere around 20% of the collections in Europe being seized for this new cultural capital that was being imagined by Hitler and the Nazis. Now, incredibly, as they were seizing all of this artwork, they had to amass it and assemble it somewhere. And so they found this, they decided upon this absolutely amazing picturesque castle in Germany. And I might butcher the pronunciation of the castle, Neuschwanstein Castle. I've always loved looking at this castle, and I think most people do. Here's just a few other views of it. It's all these kind of fanciful turrets and crenellation and that sort of thing. It's so fanciful that this is actually the castle that inspired Walt Disney to create Cinderella's castle in Disneyland. So it was this castle, though, that became the home of all of the stolen artwork from all over Europe. And here is an interior view of that castle with a soldier. And you can see all of these frames and have been wrapped up in fabric. We have sculptures that have been boxed up here. And it goes up almost two stories high. There were so much of it. They decided on this castle as a location for the stolen artwork because they didn't think that the castle was a military target. Well, by 1943, they changed their mind and they decided that they needed an even safer place to house these incredible art objects from all over Europe. So it took the better part of a year, but all of these objects were then moved to an underground salt mine. And they were moved by tank and by oxen in some case. And so this was a hidden away area, but it was also essentially sort of humidity controlled because of the salt. So here is a view inside the salt mine with all of these works that have been moved to that location. Now I wanted to zoom in on at least one of the major works that was stolen and then discovered later on in this salt mine towards the end of the war. So one of the major works that was there is this incredible piece from the early Northern Renaissance that's called the Ghent Altarpiece by the Van Eyck brothers, dates to around 1430. And there's so many incredible things about what we're looking at. And I want to sort of walk you through this altarpiece to give you a sense of appreciation for it. And then we'll take a look at the condition it was found in the salt mines. So first, just to get us started, the object that we're looking at in real life is about 12 feet tall. So you can imagine both of these panels with figures in it stacked on top of each other. Those figures would be roughly life size. And an object like this was created for a church setting, a religious setting. And it's an altarpiece, meaning that this folds open. But for the most part, it would be closed like this. It has sort of duller colors while it's closed. And then it would be opened up on major holidays or feast days. And there's just these brilliant colors that would knock your socks off. Now, let's keep in mind, this was created for audiences way before TVs, movies, anything like that. And so this would have been the whole reason to go to church, right? It's just something absolutely stunning to look at, to gaze upon. It can overwhelm your senses, particularly when we open it up. But on these exterior panels, when it's closed, let me just walk you through the story here, because it's exceptionally painted and there's so many wonderful details here. When you're talking about the early Northern Renaissance and the Van Eycks in particular, there's this incredible attention to detail. In fact, some of these details were painted with paintbrushes that had a single hair on them. That's how minute the detail is on an object so big. So in this sort of central register here, we see a religious story unfolding, and it might be one that's familiar to you. It's the Annunciation. It's the angel Gabriel over here announcing to the Virgin Mary that she is divinely pregnant. This is really a favorite subject for artists of in this time period. So it's filled with symbolism, from the white flowers here, even to the basin and the towel, which are references to Mary's purity. But we have these beautiful sort of puddles of drapery around these figures who look like they're both kneeling. If they were to stand up, their heads might go right through the ceiling of this architecture that is contemporary architecture. It's architecture that was contemporary to the time that it was painted, not the time that Jesus lived. And if you have really good eyes, you might even be able to see a contemporary cityscape just out these windows. So there was a lot here for the people of the 1400s to connect with. Just below this, you have two figures in red that are on their knees with their hands clasped in prayer. And those would have been the donors, the people that helped to fund a major work of art like this. So like I said, it's really the interior view when you open up that altarpiece that is that was created to just blow your mind. And the colors here are so rich and saturated. Again, imagine being someone who never really had beautiful visual information through most of your life. I mean, I would go out of my way to go to church and just sit in front of something like this for hours on end. Now, I should mention that that the beauty and the detail of this work of art has made it a target for thieves over the years. It's actually been dubbed the most stolen work of art of all time. I believe it's been stolen something like 13 different times. And this lower left-hand panel here has been permanently stolen. It's just gone. It's missing. And that's been since Hitler stole this work of art too. So a couple of spectacular things about this work. First and foremost, at the center here, we are looking at a depiction of God the Father, not Jesus. And it's pretty unusual in the history of art for depictions of God to exist. Sometimes he's just like a hand coming down from heaven. But in this case, he's front and center. And I want to zoom in here to give you a sense and appreciation of the detail that the Van Eycks used in painting this. Again, this is a life-size figure, and we can see essentially every hair on his head. This is a time in painting where they're so concerned about reflections and creating, you know, the shine of jewels and pearls, that sometimes you can even see the reflection of the room that the artists are working in, if not their own reflections. This depiction of God, he's wearing the triple crown of heaven, and then at his feet we have the unearthly crown here, which is absolutely encrusted in jewels and pearls. And then as we zoom back out again, you might recognize a few other figures here. Whenever you see nudes in a religious picture, it's a good guess that it's Adam and Eve. Over here we have the Virgin and John the Baptist and angels making music on either side. And then down below, this really sort of spectacular scene of all of these figures and groups coming together towards the center down here, where we have a symbol representing Jesus. And he is known, in this picture at least, as the mystical lamb. So we'll zoom in here to the center, and you can see that there's this lamb or a sheep up on an altar. There's blood springing from his chest into a chalice, and there's angels who are bringing a cross towards him. So he even has light sort of shining from the back of his head, almost like a halo in some cases. And you can see there's dozens and dozens of figures that are assembling and coming towards the mystical lamb to witness this. The figures here in the lower left are supposed to represent the Old Testament. And you actually have figures who are kneeling here reading the Old Testament. I'll zoom in. Oh, there's our mystical lamb. And here you can see these figures. The artists have actually painted the text of the Old Testament here. It's legible over their shoulders. You can even see that some of them are in need of a shave. That's the level of detail and appreciation that has gone into a work like this. One other detail that I've always loved here is over the shoulders of these women who are marching in with these palm fronds sort of fanning out above them is the detail of this contemporary cityscape in the background. It's just, you've got skyscrapers, you've got churches and towers. It's just this incredible amount of detail here. It's absolutely awe-inspiring. So if you don't already have a total appreciation for this work of art, well, I don't know what more to show you, but it always breaks my heart when we go back to these salt mines where the Nazis were storing these works, and you can see what happened to them. The Ghent altarpiece was disassembled, so all of these pictures were taken apart to be stored. Makes sense because it's such a large image, but you can see there's our mystical lamb again, and there's all these pieces that have been essentially kind of torn away from the surface of the picture. A few more scenes here. We see the angels, and there's Eve in the background, and we see this group that's known as the Monuments Men, who came in to help find these treasures and restore them to their rightful owners. Just one more scene here with our donors in the background and a few of the people who are assembling to see the mystical lamb. So, and you can see the damage on almost all of these panels that existed. So this work has been heavily restored since then. One other object that I wanted to note that was found in the salt mines was this sculpture, a depiction of the Virgin Mary and the Christ child. And this was by Michelangelo. It's one of, I believe it's his only sculpture that was outside of Italy. It was in Bruges, and it was stolen by the Nazis, eventually wound up in the salt mine. And here's just this absolutely incredible image of them getting this same sculpture out of the salt mine. You can see that it's all wrapped up in like this chaos of different fabrics. I would not want to be the person responsible for moving that object in particular, but it is safe and sound today. So with that, we're going to turn our attention to the last art heist here that we're going to be talking about tonight, and that is the theft of the Gardner Museum in Boston. And here's a historic photo of the exterior of the Gardner Museum. Mrs. Gardner, Isabella Stewart Gardner, decided that she would build her museum on the Fenway, just sort of outside of the city at the time. But it was sort of the perfect selection for her because she so loved the city of Venice, and she was essentially building her museum on marshland too. It was built according to the same principles of building, with driving pilings straight into the ground, and the museum sort of resting on top of those pilings. If you've ever been to the museum, you know that the interior, that the courtyard there, is one of the most gorgeous spaces in all of New England. It's the very best place to be in like the gray, cold months of winter in particular. And I've always said that the best job at the Gardner is to be the chief horticulturalist, because they are constantly updating the gardens, constantly moving them. The curators, unfortunately, can't really change anything there, because according to Mrs. Gardner's will, everything, she installed the entire collection. She decided where everything went. And so according to her will, if anything were to ever be moved or changed or bought or sold, the entire collection would be dismantled, shipped to Paris, auctioned off, and all the money would go to Harvard. So her museum is just how she left it. Now, I want to just draw your attention to the fact that from this view here, we can see multiple stories and all these different windows and balconies and balustrades. And all of these architectural fragments came from palaces in Italy for the most part. But you'll notice that they're from different buildings. They don't all match. This is like a pointed Gothic arch. This is kind of a curved OG arch over here. And then down at the bottom, we have these rounded Roman arches. So it's interesting to, again, even think of that notion of cultural theft once again. Mrs. Gardner paid for these objects, but where do they really belong? All right, so I want to sort of move you through some of her museum, just in case you've never been there before, so that you can get a sense of what this place looked like. When she was a very young woman, she traveled through Italy and she got to visit Florence and the Pitti Palace. And if you've ever been to the Pitti Palace before, it would probably remind you exactly of the Gardner, because while she visited, she said, if I ever have any money of my own, this is exactly the kind of museum I want to create. It's a space that looks like this, her Raphael room, large galleries that are filled with furniture, and the walls are covered with beautiful fabrics and works of art by, you know, Renaissance masters, essentially. So she put her Raphael in the best possible place, right next to the window, so it gets the best lighting. And of course, we know today that that's the light that deteriorates a painting. Over here on the right is her consecrated chapel. This is another gallery in the museum. And every year on her birthday, they still hold services for her there. Now, if you go through her museum sort of organically up the stairs, around the courtyard, up the next set of stairs, you wind up in the Gothic room. And that's the last stop of the museum. And it's so interesting to see sort of how she's incorporated herself into this space. She took this portrait of her by John Singer Sargent. It's roughly life size, painted in 1888. And she installed it behind this wooden chest with this giant book in front of it. So she's essentially created an altar to herself as the very last stop in her museum. And you'll notice too that this painting of her seems to suggest a halo, maybe even a crown, maybe even wings beyond her. So it's kind of the perfect object to put into a room full of Gothic and early Renaissance art. So this museum is really unlike any other. It has her personality stamped in every single sort of decision around display. And that's what makes the theft of this museum all the more tragic. And of course, you're probably familiar with the story at this point. It was March 18th, the night of St. Patrick's Day in Boston in 1990, that two men who were dressed as Boston City police officers went to the back door of the museum, essentially the staff entrance. They found out early on, or perhaps they already knew going in, that there were two night guards that were working. They rounded them up, tied them up, taped them up, and put them down in sort of like a utility room, but beneath the museum. And then they spent close to the next 90 minutes going through this really sort of dense collection of art and selecting, seemingly very carefully, objects to steal. Now, I always thought of this as like a gentleman's crime for so many years, because, you know, I've seen the Thomas Crown Affair, and you just imagine they took their time. You know, it's like perhaps they were even enjoying the art as they moved through the museum. But when you see the crime scene photos, you're reminded that this wasn't really a gentleman's crime. They took some things off the wall and they smashed the glass. They smashed the frames. Interestingly, they took the time to unscrew certain frames from the wall. Their modus operandi really sort of changed depending on which objects we're talking about. But it's this room that we're looking at here, the Dutch room, that was really hard hit with this crime. And we see a number of frames on the floor here. Here's a contemporary view of the Dutch room, what it looks like today. And so you'll notice that, you know, there's still plenty of artwork and historical furniture here, but there's three very prominent empty frames when you walk into this room. And they are, of course, still there today because of Mrs. Gardner's will. Nothing can be moved, changed, bought, or sold. But also, they're there because we all certainly hope that those artworks come back and that their home is sort of sitting there waiting for them. Now, some of these works, and there were two major Rembrandt paintings in these two big frames, were just cut right out of their frames and probably just rolled right up and brought out of the museum. Let me give you a view of those two Rembrandts. There's this kind of family portrait here, a lady and gentleman in black from 1633. I love looking at this work because it is so, it's like classic Dutch Baroque here. We have these figures in these kind of inky black clothes. It always reminds me that Rembrandt was painting at the same time that you have pilgrims coming over to America. It's that same look with these big kind of starched collars as well. X-rays reveal that there was a child who was also included in this portrait, but he did not survive and he was ultimately painted out, which is sort of a heartbreaking detail here. A lot of people talk about just how unfortunate it is that this painting on the right was stolen as well, because it's the only painting that Rembrandt ever created that's on the sea, his only seascape. Well, that sounds horrible. It's his only seascape and it's gone. But it really is a remarkable picture beyond the fact that it's painted on the sea. Again, there's a lot here that's kind of classic Dutch Baroque. We've got these strong diagonals that are the basis of the composition and really dramatic lighting as well. I want to draw your attention to the fact that this is Christ on the Sea of Galilee. So you can probably see Jesus right down here. He's in a boat with his apostles. The boat is being just tossed around on these gigantic waves, and he is like this calm center. And some of his apostles are sitting here listening very attentively to what he has to say. Some of them are working against Mother Nature here, furiously trying to ensure all of their safety. One of them is getting sick over the edge of the boat here, and one of them looks out directly at us. And that is a Rembrandt self-portrait there, which is just kind of a fantastic detail. There was another Rembrandt self-portrait that was stolen as a part of this crime. And I always find this one fascinating because this picture is, it's a little etching and it was about the size of a postage stamp. So imagine being able to find something like that in this really sort of dense installation that Mrs. Gardner created. Beyond that, there were works from from French Impressionism that were stolen. This is a work by the artist Manet over here. This is Degas. Other historic works were stolen. An ancient Chinese beaker that dates back to, I believe, 10,000 BC. It was the only Chinese object and the only object that old to be stolen. And then this is a finial from a Napoleonic flag that was also stolen. It's interesting, in the Netflix documentary, the police talk about the theft of these objects as sort of being like a red herring because they really didn't fit in with the other objects that were stolen. And then you have the theft of the Vermeer here, which is really tragic because there are only about 30-35 Vermeer paintings ever created, and this was one of them. So they talk about this work probably being the most valuable out of all the objects that was stolen. This is called The Concert, and it dates to 1664. This is just a gorgeous little painting. We've got this sort of beam of light coming in from the left here, and this really sort of beautifully realized three-dimensional space, kind of reinforced by the wonderful patterning on the floor. We've got a trio of figures, one of them playing what kind of looks like a harpsichord, and one of them standing over here with the music in her hands. And I love this gesture with her hand as though she's sort of conjuring the music off the page and like up through her lungs and out of her mouth. It is as though she is about to burst into song. Now, there is something a little sensual about this picture that I think a lot of contemporary viewers might not pick up on. But if you have good eyes, you can probably see there's some paintings on the back wall here, including this kind of amorous depiction of three figures on the back wall. There's a woman here, and it looks like she's kind of being embraced by the male figure in the center. So there's kind of the suggestion that there's something romantic at play in this room where all the music's being made, that these figures are literally in accord with each other. Now, one last note about the Gardner theft. There's 13 works of art stolen in general, and this one happened to have been taken off the wall the night that the robbers were there, but they decided to leave it. And perhaps it's because this is painted on a panel and it wasn't just a work of art that you could cut and roll up and walk out with. So this is a very early Rembrandt self-portrait. He was a young artist trying to prove himself. He hadn't even moved to the big city of Amsterdam yet. And here, I love this self-portrait so much. He's essentially playing dress up to show rich potential clients that he could paint all the wonderful things that they own. So I always think of this as a picture about texture. And you can imagine touching every part of it, like running your hand down that feather in his cap. And then you get here to this kind of silky hat on his head. His hair is like this this mess of curls. You can imagine the texture of his hair. Then he only has a little bit of peach fuzz on his chin here. And then you move down to the scarf around his neck. And this is a painting that merits seeing it in person because that scarf has gold thread woven into it. And then you get to this green cloak that he's wearing. And even looking at it in a reproduction at home tonight, you probably know exactly what material that cloak is made out of, right? It's velvet. You can imagine touching that velvet. He does that all so well. So I'm so glad that picture is still there. And just to wrap up this section on art heists, we know that there was an incredible reward that was offered for the return of these objects. And we are still waiting for that return to happen. And just a quick note to say that art heists still happen all the time around the world. This is a really brazen art heist in Oslo, Norway, where you have people just running out of a museum in the middle of the day with works of art and putting it in this, you know, dinky little getaway car. So sometimes works of art get stolen repeatedly, the same works of art. And oftentimes it is, these works are used as bargaining chips to help get people out of jail. So it's really interesting to think of how this continues to play out and the pressure that it would put on museum security as well. So let's turn our attention to art attacks. I know we're running really short on time, but this is a little less involved. We're going to start off here at the Vatican, at St. Peter's Basilica, and start with Michelangelo's Pietà, one of the most incredible, beautiful works of art of the High Renaissance, an incredible depiction of the concept of the divinity of figures being expressed through their perfect beauty. And in this case, we have, you know, Jesus, who's just come down off the cross, looking gorgeous. His mother, the mother of a 33-year-old man here, looking, you know, no older than 20. And they are just sort of beautifully expressed. And one of the features, one of the elements of this massive marble sculpture that's carved out of a single piece of marble before Michelangelo was even 25 years old, it's this little gesture here that my eye is always gone to. And I think you can read it in two different ways. It's sort of like, in one way, kind of, you know, she's offering up her son. It's like she understands the sacrifice. And as a mother, I can also imagine in some ways that it's kind of questioning why. It's the heartbreak that's also there as a mother. Now, this picture, like I said, it's an expression of divinity through perfect beauty. And this is a real change from the way that artists had been creating Pietà scenes in the past. So Michelangelo was really innovative with his work. And here's just some close-ups of those beautiful faces here. Now, in 1971, a man by the name of Laszlo Toth, he was an Australian, Hungarian-born Australian geologist. He moves to Rome and he's starts going around telling people that he's Jesus. Sometimes he would tell people that he was Michelangelo. The following year, when he turned 33, the same age that Jesus was when he died, he took one of those geologist hammers that he had, went to St. Peter's Basilica, and attacked the Pietà. And this is an actual photo of him being pulled away. And you can see that the Virgin Mary's hand here is gone. He was able to deliver, I think, anywhere between 12 to 15 blows on the Pietà. So you can see he really damaged her face, parts of the veil, and of course, her hand here. There was one person who witnessed the attack who actually took a piece of the hand home and then later felt guilty about it and returned it. Laszlo Toth, I should mention, was hospitalized for 2 years following this and then immediately deported. That's like the worst crime you can do in Italy, is attack a Michelangelo. So fortunately, they had pieces to kind of reassemble this incredible work of art. And amazingly, they had taken a mold of the entire sculpture before it had ever been attacked. So these little pieces, like her eyelid that had been damaged, and you can see she lost her entire nose. She got the Mary that's there today has a nose job, essentially, but they were able to perfectly replicate this work of art because that mold did exist. But there's really no good reason for Laszlo Toth to have committed this crime other than the fact that he was probably severely mentally unstable at the time. So when you go to the Vatican today, you can still see it, but this is another work of art that is now behind bulletproof glass because of that attack. So we're going to move from Italy over to the Netherlands and go to the Rijksmuseum, which of course is filled with Dutch art. And probably the most significant work of art that is there is Rembrandt's painting that's known as the Night Watch. This is the nickname for this painting because it was heavily varnished at one point and it really sort of darkened, so it looks like a night scene. So that's how it gets this nickname. It's a 1642 painting, and it is huge. It's on an enormous scale. And it's a very innovative painting because what we're looking at here is a depiction of a militia. And there were tons of militia paintings that were done during this time. And for the most part, other artists just painted them like school picture day, just lined up figures right in rows, made sure everybody's face was visible. Rembrandt's innovation here was to make it look like they were being called into action. So they are mobilizing in this scene. And we have their leaders here in the foreground, and we have people with all sorts of different weaponry and costumes. A lot of it is very anachronistic because these are just random helmets and other weapons that Rembrandt had sitting around in his studio. This is a picture that has fascinated art historians and the public for centuries. There's all sorts of bizarre details here, my favorite of them being this little golden girl. What is she doing back here, and why does she have a chicken hanging upside down from her waistband? So there's a lot going on here, but this is a picture that is sort of like the Mona Lisa to the Rijksmuseum. It's a picture that people attack when they feel like they have a political statement to make. And here, over here on the left, we can see the results of one of those attacks. So it's been attacked multiple times. In the 1970s, there was a school teacher who attacked it with a knife. Even before that, you had an unemployed shoemaker who attacked it with one of the tools that he made for making shoes. And that's how you got these slashes in particular. But even since then, people have thrown acid at it. Believe it or not, the guards were prepared for that and immediately neutralized that work of art. So then if and when you go to the Rijksmuseum today, you can be a part of that crush of people that get right in as close as possible to enjoy all of these details. If you can't get to the Rijksmuseum, incredibly, there's a lot of information and great high resolution images available online. This is a great image that was circulating a few years ago as a sort of, oh, kids these days kind of moment, because all of these kids are sitting in front of this wonderful work of art and they're all on their phones, but apparently they were doing an assignment for the time. So they recently restored it and they did a live online feed. And so they broadcasted these really incredible images up close and personal personal with this work of art to the entire world. I think they started that in 2019, so I'm sure they are done by now. So it's amazing that this work has been this kind of object that has attracted the vitriol of people over the years. And it's been an opportunity to make a political statement. And then also it has just been sort of like attracted people who had different grievances with the government as well. So the last work in terms of art attacks that I wanted to share with you is a more contemporary artist, the anonymous street artist named Banksy. So this is sort of like a cartoon representation of his anonymous status, but you might've seen works like these two that are included in this image. So he is a UK-based anonymous artist. His works have this kind of dark sense of humor on them, associated with them. And he's become so famous and so popular since he started tagging buildings that that buildings that he tags go up in value. The neighborhoods become tourist destinations. And actually, incredibly, his art sells. It sells really well. I love this particular tag here where it says, "This will look nice when it's framed." A lot of people think, how do you sell graffiti art? Well, he has an organization that authenticates his work, and occasionally they sell original reproductions of his work through that organization. So one of his most famous pictures is of this little girl who is letting go of a red balloon, and it's just called Girl with the Balloon or Red Balloon. And this has been around since the early 2000s, and it's shown up on buildings and structures in different parts of the world, but originally it was seen in London. And so occasionally Banksy will allow for or will create original paintings to sell at, on the art market. And these works have gone up in value so much because essentially a lot of celebrities started collecting them. So there's a great documentary, if you've never seen it before, it's called Exit Through the Gift Shop. And it's all about the commercialization of street art. It is a fantastic movie. It's really funny. So this particular painting, Girl with the Balloon, was recently sold at auction at Sotheby's in 2018, I believe it was. And it was sold for $1.3 million. And just as the gavel fell, the frame that was housing that picture immediately began to shred the picture. And this caused an uproar in the art world. I love the reactions of these people as they're looking at this thing that just sold for more than $1 million as it's being destroyed here. Sotheby's sort of celebrated it. They said this was the first artwork in history to have been created during a live auction. So we have this notion that by destroying this work of art, he has created something new. And actually Banksy's his organization that authenticates his work, they have said that this is in fact a new work of art. It has a new name, Love is in the Bin. And even the person who bought the work has decided to keep it. And they thought, you know, this is a whole new Banksy and there's a great story that goes along with it. Banksy himself has authenticated this work of art. And he even said that his intention was to destroy the whole painting. This is a little view of the back of that frame. He posted some videos to Instagram following the destruction of this work of art. And he said something to the effect of, it worked perfectly in all of our rehearsals. So he had intended this picture to be completely shredded. So Banksy is our segue to our last and our sort of quickest section here on art fraud. And Banksy is another theft here. We've got the quote, "The bad artists imitate, the great artists steal." It's often falsely attributed to Picasso. Banksy just says, crosses out Picasso and he adds his own name here. So in some cases, forgery is about artists stealing from each other, going back to, you know, the gallery in the Louvre and copying somebody else's work. That is actually how Michelangelo got his start, or really sort of achieved early fame. He was able to to create a sculpture of a sleeping Cupid, very much like the one that you see here on the right. And he added different chemicals to it to make it look aged. And he presented the sleeping Cupid as a work from classical antiquity, a work that was essentially 1500 years old. And he fooled people, but then the ruse was revealed. And the fact that he could create something that authentically looked like it was from the classical past elevated his status as an artist. And it's interesting to think that, you know, when you can fool people like that, sometimes it works in your favor. Sometimes you end up in jail. One other quick story related to forgery and an artist that you might be familiar with is Salvador Dali, ever the showman. And he was, of course, the early 20th century. Well, he had a nice long career, but the leader of the Surrealist movement. And he's best known for this work over here on the right, The Persistence of Memory, which is in the collection of the MoMA, dates to 1931, the famous picture of the melting clocks. Dali rose to international fame because he would paint these very realistic pictures that were like these dreamscapes. He said he was painting his own dreams. But towards the end of his career, he did something that has put him sort of in negative favor with the art world. And that is a big cache of papers were discovered that he had already signed, but had not actually created any artwork on. So we know that he was just signing works of art and letting his students create, or his apprentices create anything on it, and then it was being sold as authentic Dali. So it was a money-making proposition. And this really sort of walks a fine line in terms of what artists have done in the past. You could sort of say, well, wasn't Andy Warhol doing things like this? Weren't the great Italian Renaissance masters with, you know, extensive workshops doing something like this? But because Dali was somebody who earned his reputation as creating original works of art by hand, the fact that he did this later on in life, seemingly as a money-making proposition, has certainly put soured his reputation for many in the art world. And it certainly means that if you've bought a Dali print, it calls into question its authenticity. So we'll wrap up with just two professional art forgers, but who you probably don't know by name, and maybe only by reputation. So the first forger that we're looking at here is a man by the name of John Myatt, and you get a sense for how capable he is in an image like this. Now, he was a regular old artist who wanted to spend more time with his children. So he advertised the fact that he could make these great copies of original works of art in a trade magazine for private detectives. And another man saw that he could do this, and they worked together to kind of monetize this and create create works of art that they could then pass off as being originals. And in order to do this, oftentimes they had to create a whole history for these works of art. They would slip documents into archives to create a whole story that spoke to the fact that these works have existed for long periods of time. Now you can't do that in archives. They are very, very concerned about these fake histories being created to support a forged work of art like this. Now, he and his accomplice went on to sell these kind of genuine fakes, and they made tens of thousands of dollars off of this. And this particular forger ended up spending 6 years in jail. Today, he continues to make forgeries, but he is very upfront and honest with the fact that he's making genuine fakes. When you purchase his works, that's exactly what you know that you are going to get. And Scotland Yard has determined that the sale of his forged works yielded approximately £25 million over the years. So it's interesting to think what might still be out there if all of them have been discovered even. And that's sort of the thorny issue that comes in with this last forger that I'm just going to tell you about very quickly. This is Amir Dohori, and he was another really talented talented forger. He worked primarily after World War II. He kind of billed himself as a Hungarian aristocrat who was kind of selling off his own collection, but he was creating these works, and he wasn't so much focused on master artists from the past. He was forging contemporary works and modern masterpieces. He also had an accomplice, and they were able to place a lot of these paintings at auction and in museum collections. And he says there's 1,000 objects or more that are still out there in the art market today. So I'll just give you a sense in terms of the kinds of forgeries that he created. He would look at a Picasso like the one on the left and create an image like the one on the right. He looked at Modigliani like the one on the left and create an image like we see on the right. I think for many of us who are not trained in authenticating works of art, these could certainly pass for originals. And then finally here, we have Matisse on the left and a forgery of a Matisse over here on the right. So he had a real knack for capturing the essence of somebody's style. But in the end, he was exposed. And I'm sure that museums around the world are trying to put a lockdown on whether or not objects that they've purchased in the past few decades are in fact originals. So we'll wrap up tonight. Just going back to some of these big pictures, our takeaways from looking at theft and forgeries and attacks. Well, it's a reminder as we look at these objects that that the authenticity of an original work of art still has tremendous value to our culture. That's why the frames are still waiting. That's why there's still, you know, this dispute about where the Elgin marbles belong. And it's also a reminder that that when a work of art is destroyed, the sort of rippling effects that has, whether it's in politics or religion or just in the art world, really, that these works matter to us so much, but they're not just, you know, an artifact. They say so much more about us as a civilization. So the purposeful destruction of these works has ramifications far beyond the artwork itself. And then finally, as we're thinking about forgery too, we keep in mind that it is still the most sincerest form of flattery, and that we are still to this day sort of drawn to that aura of the authentic masterpiece. And I think for so many of us now that we're kind of coming out on the other side of COVID, it's that excuse to get back into the museums and to see these things in person. So I will wrap up there for now. And I welcome any questions or comments anybody has, and thank all of you for staying with me a little bit late tonight. Sorry, I went on for so long. So thank you, everybody. And I'll just start going through some of these questions.
Thank you, Jane. There was a lot of great comments. And yeah, you're right. I think there's a divide. I mean, among librarians, I think we tend to share more than we should. And I think there's been a book, there was a book published called The Art of Stealing or something, or How to Be a Great Artist by Stealing, or can't remember what it was called, but yeah. The art, and it was based on the misappropriated Picasso quote. But what is behind that quote? Like, I mean, how much do you share? How much do you take? And how much attribution do you provide if you are going to borrow?
Right. And I mean, like, how much innovation can any artist bring to what they do today? I mean, everybody who's successful in the arts is standing on the shoulders of the people that came before them, you know? And that's true for so many different fields as well. So you kind of have to start with what's there, and if you can master it, it's like all the better, but but hopefully you can find something to express that is your own.
But yeah, I mean, I think that one of the Hunter S. Thompson famously recited F. Scott Fitzgerald or Hemingway or one of those before he actually started writing his own stuff. And you know, that's how he made his voice. So that's just
interesting. Well, I'm seeing these very nice messages and I appreciate every single one of them. Thank you so much, everyone. I really appreciate it. And I'm so glad that we get to see each other again a few more times this summer.
Yeah. A lot of fun. Chantel asked, why doesn't the Gardner Museum put up copies instead of empty frames?
That's a really good question. You know, I had like a 1 year position while I was in grad school working in the marketing department of the Gardner. And I remember that the head of marketing, who was this like wonderful woman who worked there at the time, she had said to me too, she said, we don't want to be just the museum that's known for empty frames. We don't want people to think of, you know, the place that's been robbed. Why go and see it like that? So I'm sure that's something that they've always just grappled with, because to a certain extent, it's a piece that fascinates everybody. And it prompts a lot of great conversations. I mean, I probably would always give an hour-long tour and then spend another 20 minutes just chit-chatting with people about the theft, because that's what people are really intrigued by. So it's an opportunity to have those discussions and then to keep that theft in the public eye, because you still want those paintings returned. And in a museum where, I mean, you have these incredible works of art that are still there. You've got the Rembrandt, you've got the Titian, you've got Raphael's. You know, it seems to cheapen it to say like, okay, well, we'll just put some posters in place. Mm-hmm. So I can imagine it's a thorny issue for them. And there's probably no perfect solution there, but it definitely keeps people talking about the missing works. And then hopefully the more people know, the more likely they'll be returned.
And along those lines, Rachel asks, the Mona Lisa was stolen because an Italian thought the painting belonged to Italians.
Yeah.
How do museums deal with claims from other nations for their art back?
I feel like there's only now more productive discussions around this, because I think for centuries, museums were essentially like, this is our collection and it's like infallible. You can't touch it. You know, once it's a part of, once it's in our, within our walls, it's ours. And so I think there's a greater cultural sensitivity now in the arts in so many different aspects from teaching it, from curating collections, that I think that people are grappling now more with the idea that certain works really do belong to certain peoples and that they shouldn't necessarily be in museums if that's the case. But that's, I mean, I don't know where you draw the line there. It's a really interesting issue. And I know that the Louvre wouldn't want to give the Mona Lisa back to the Italians today. But I'm glad you mentioned that, Rachel, because that is, I mean, that's something that is definitely changing in our culture now.
Yeah, I mean, I think about the Gettys and their ownership over a lot of the photography that is available on the web. Like you can't, what was it? The Woman in Gold, or one of those that was stolen from the Israeli people?
From Jewish people.
The
Nazis. And that's my art talk in November, I think. That's going to be like much more on Nazi art theft. But that's a great story, because ultimately there's restitution. And I think like we're more accustomed to those kinds of conversations when we know that it was like such an evil entity, like the Nazis stole it, but it's harder when it's like, oh, it's the British Museum. It's this esteemed cultural institution. So yeah, I'm really happy that you mentioned the Klimt painting there, because that's another dimension, and you can just see how this is all shades of gray there. Yeah,
absolutely. I mean, there's everything from colonialism to the Nazis. I mean, that's really what the British Museum is trying to grapple with right now. Excellent. Did anyone else have any other questions? Yeah. Elaine says the ethics of art, the art world is interesting, i.e. Sackler opioid guilt.
Yes. So they made all this money off of what, right. Like Oxycontin or something like right. that. But they're major patrons of the arts. So yeah, the ethics are fascinating to say the least.
Yeah. I had a question for you actually concerning current events. I was wondering if you were going to do anything on digital art and non-fungible.
I think I have to learn a little bit more about it.
I know, but I just wondered how much that was affecting art, but maybe in the future.
It's a fascinating conversation. Maybe like for the beginning of 2022.
Awesome. You've been busy this year, definitely.
Yeah.
But thank you so much, Jane. And we really appreciate your time tonight. We'll look forward to our July conversation. What was it, July 27th?
Yes.
Yes. Yep. And that will be on the art of the French Revolution, yeah. called Off With Their Heads. I'm really looking forward to it. Thank you so much, Jane.
Thank you everybody for coming tonight and for your nice comments. I really appreciate it. Take care.